There we go. Right. Okay. So, we've been having a pretty good last couple of weeks experimenting with different painting techniques. So we've looked at quite a few different artists. I've got one more to show, well, actually two more to show you tonight, because what I thought we'd do is, because when we've watched a lot of these videos, we can see that artists are using anything from a palette knife to a piece of plastic to spread the paint onto the surface of the picture when they're actually making the portrait. So I thought, we could try that out this evening. Now I know some of you might not have palette knives and things like that. So because different artists use different materials to paint with, as in, not just a palette knife, I've got a few other things that you can try out as well. And the other thing I thought we'd do is, because we've looked at maybe making a blue background or a background color to paint on, but I thought we'd try putting a different textured background or using different materials in the background. Now, we've done that sort of thing previously in some of the classes as well, but this time we'll be using the paints in a slightly different way as well. So I want to show you a couple of examples of artists that use these kinds of techniques just now, and then we'll go through what we've done. I'll qu very quickly go through what we've done previously, and I'll show you these videos as well. Okay, so let's go over to the wall. Yay! Okay, so we've looked at this artist here, which was Paul Wright, and his expressive mark making techniques. So let me just see if I can make him a bit bigger. It doesn't look like I can because he's stuck up there in the corner. There, I can make him a bit bigger over here. So he uses all these like very flowing brush strokes. In fact, when we talked about this, how the brush strokes come right out over the cheek and things, you can see that there. So he's not afraid for some of the paint to go into the background. And that's what I explored last week. And what I wanted people to try as well was, rather than simply copying another artist's work, is actually to create one from a photograph that you've got. So you find a photograph and then you use similar techniques to the artist. So in this case, Paul Wright uses these sweeping brush strokes and things. So that was pretty much what we did last week. And we also talked a bit about color and how there's these really strong reds and greens appearing in the picture as well, which add nice accents and create this really nice contemporary feel to the picture. So, I mean, a lot of the pictures we're looking at are very contemporary, either in the style of brush strokes that they use or the colors that they use and so on. So it's quite an interesting one that we looked at. And I'll show you the one that I did last week again in a few minutes, because I've managed to finish that one off in the Tuesday class. So I'll show you that in just a few minutes. Now, let's just move that over there a little bit. Right. So there's a few artists here that use different techniques that I'm going to just talk about. So this one here is Francoise Neil. Just here, Neela, or I can't remember. I never remember the names. But I really loved, because a lot of you are really getting into these super bright colours in your pictures too. And this artist uses really strong, bold, bright colours in her work. So I've got a very quick video of her using a palette knife to spread paint over the surface of her pictures to create these really bold paintings with lovely patches of different colours on there. You'll notice on this one there's these lovely bold dark, well, black outlines around the outside of the picture, and then a very neutral grey in the background, which helps emphasize the portrait. I'm going to be having a go with this portrait tonight because I really like the really solid, strong looking structure of the face. So, And also, of course, I like the pictures and the bold outlines in there too. So that was one that I thought was quite an interesting artist. And I'll show you some more of those in a minute. And then there's another artist called Jimmy Law, who I'm going to kind of try and mix some of Jimmy Law's techniques up with some of the stuff we do. This is actually Andrew Segaldo, who I showed a video of a few weeks ago, this one. I'm going to show you Jimmy Law in a few seconds. And then this one was Meal. I think it was Joseph Meals. And he is interested in the trying to hide or mask the emotion of the person that he's painting. And he uses really thick layers of paint as well. So they're kind of the inspiration for this evening. There was one more random one that I found just here, which is a little bit different to the rest in a sense, because it is almost like all the paint has just been squashed up and layered constantly over each other, and it creates this kind of impressionist effect, if you like, because it's like the person is in the dark, in a darkened place with a little bit of light catching them. But you can see the amount of paint that's been layered on top of each other to create this beautiful kind of mysterious effect in the picture. So let's go on now. I'm going to show you Francoise Neil on. It's only a minute long, but it's quite interesting just to watch. And the interesting thing again, of course, is that the picture is very big as well. So I really like that. I love the way that the artist is kind of sweeping and curving the palette knife around as they're using it as well. And the way the paint is layered on top of each other again. And also how it mixes as the paint palettes go around the surface. Now, Jimmy Law doesn't use palette knives, but he uses... He seems to use pieces of plastic to do his work with. So again, it's not a palette knife, but it is something that you can use to spread paint. So all of these techniques are quite adaptable. Obviously a palette knife might offer a bit of flexibility, but sometimes if you take away flexibility and you present a little bit of a restriction, it can actually bring out different results in a picture as well. So we'll have a quick look at him. It's only a small part of a longer interview, but it's quite nice just to watch how he uses the paint.
But at the same time, also still very representative. I use quite bold strokes with paintbrushes and palette knives and that sort of thing. Often just throwing paint on a canvas and let it just run down. So in parts it's quite messy, but in parts it's also quite detailed, especially around the person's features, you know, the eyes and that sort of thing. It's often quite detailed. Lately I've been experimenting with obscuring features a little bit. I just felt that it makes it a bit more interesting to look at, and it actually it makes the viewer ask a bit more questions when when they look at my paintings. My work, I really just want to do beautiful paintings. I do have a tendency to do work where, you know, most of our subjects have my poker faces. There's no real emotion. But I think in the process, in the technique that I use and the way that I interpret, you know, my own paintings, they do come across quite somber. And I think in most cases, subjects look a little bit sad, but definitely not happy. I just don't do happy paintings. I just don't. You know, happy is a very singular emotion, and what I like to provoke in my paintings is I actually like people to wonder a little bit, you know, about the subject's condition. Certainly in some works, the subjects do look a little bit disturbed, but that is intentional.
Right, so you could see there that he had different things that he was painting with. He was also mixing the paint with what looked like a piece of plastic. And the way he applied the paint was in little movements like that to create little blocks of colour on the picture as well. So if you're interested in the way that either of those artists work, then what I suggest is having a quick scoot around on the internet and finding a few pictures from those artists. I have just published on the website the names of the artists and so forth. So you can find them there. But Jimmy Law is a fairly obvious one. And Francoise Nielly, I think her name is. I'll double check that I've got the second name right in a few minutes. But really, so this is something that I'm going to be demonstrating and doing today. But first, I'm just going to talk a little bit about backgrounds and things. So if we go over here, and we'll have a quick look at some of these. So, hello. Right, so here's my examples that I've been doing the last couple of weeks. Some of you will have seen these during the last few lessons. So the first one, I created a background using blue, and you can clearly see the background there, and I left some areas sort of showing up and showing through. So you could potentially do that with what we're going to be doing today. And with Jimmy Law's work, you know, you can see this similar idea of doing or leave it or making patches of colours by using smaller brush strokes and things. On there, so it's a similar sort of thing, but each artist does a slightly different thing with it. And I was reading a quote today from Picasso, and he said that it's always good, it's a good thing to copy from other artists, because most of the time, or pretty much all of the time, you can't do it exactly in the way that the artist has done it, and but that's when you start to get something interesting and new out of your work. So doing this sort of thing is a really valuable way of learning and developing your own stuff. And then we go over here. This is what we did last week. So the idea last week was simply to make a drawing, and you could trace that outline if you wanted to, and use an artist as your inspiration for creating the painting. So I chose this one, which I think was Matt Damon when he was a bit younger, I suspect, but I'm not entirely sure. And I really like the way that he used these long brush strokes that overlapped. So I drew this out, and then I created my own kind of Paul Wright version of the picture using these brush strokes. So I mean, that was a really good experience trying out working from a different artist. All right, so what we're going to do first of all is we're going to create a background. So this is the painting that I'm planning to work from today, but what I'd like to do, I think, is combine it with a little bit of something like this, like an Andrew Segaldo, who we looked at a few weeks ago in a video. Maybe not as gruesome looking as that one, but taking some of these nice mark making techniques and employing them on a picture inspired by this, which is Francoise Nielly. So on to backgrounds. Oh, and there's another one by Jimmy Page that I also liked. So I'll be looking at a few different pictures while we're doing this. Now, as far as spreading paint goes, earlier on, I made this background and I've used a few different things that I had lying around. So I had some brown tape that I used to send off my artwork when people have ordered something from me. And I use it to help packaging. It's really nice, like paper. It's like masking tape, but it's brown. And then I've used lots of strips of newspaper and things as well. Now, what you can do when you've done that, of course, is you can get some colour, or in this case, I'm using white so that I can draw back over it easily. Ooh, my plate's a bit wet. And then a piece of cardboard can be used just to scrape the paint on the surface. So you can see just here, I've got some of the paint on there, and then I can literally start to create more of a neutral background that isn't quite as busy, but you still get the raised texture on the surface of the paper, but you also have a nice surface to draw on, and one that you can use either a palette knife or a piece of plastic. So the other thing I've also got here is I've got some little pieces of plastic that I'm going to try and paint with in a similar way that Jimmy Page yeah, Jimmy Law does. And if you haven't got anything like that, then this is what I recommend as well. You could try, and it is worth, even if you've got palette knives and things like that, it's worth having a little try with some other materials that you might be able to find. Because let's face it, there is tons of plastic lying around in the world today. So I've also got this, which is from a Bertoli box, which I'll have a little play with at the same time. One of the things I did on this piece of plastic just here is, and I'll just zoom in and show you a little bit, is I've made it into kind of a comb shape as well, which I can also use on top of the portrait and things when I do that a bit later as well. So Jimmy Law talks about occasionally he just tries something slightly different out when he's doing his drawings and pictures. Okay, so it's worth just having a little go with something you haven't tried before, as we often do. Now here is some of the, I'll just zoom back out again. So here's some of the background that I've already started messing around with here. So just a quick sort of idea about what I did with this. So I got a brush this sort of size and some glue. I realize I haven't, I didn't mention in my email to get these things together. So if you haven't got all of these things together and you don't feel prepared, then perhaps try looking at a different artist today. And then when you've got time, you can then start to do this sort of thing. So what I do is I'm not being frugal with my glue. I'm just putting it down quite heavily, not being too precious or thinking too much about it. But usually I like my strips of paper to go off in one sort of direction like that. And with the brown paper, it's also nice. It's brilliant stuff because you get as long as you want. You can also tear it like this to make some interesting shapes and things, so it looks a bit more natural when you're applying it to the surface. And then of course you can add other strips going off in different directions as well, like that. And as you know, I do a lot of paper collage in my own work as well, so I have got loads of bits of coloured paper that I print off. So this could come from magazines and stuff too. And then a bit later on, what I can do is apply with my pallet card, if you want to call it that, I can apply a bit more color or white back over the surface. And I always find that it makes it a much more interesting surface to work back over, because you're kind of breaking the breaking the ice with the paper a little bit in some ways as well. I've got another bit of green text there that I've printed off for a picture that I'm doing. I can use a bit of that in there too. So what I'd normally do now is shove that on the heater next to me and let that dry, but I'm going to just go for it and put some white straight over it and see what happens. So I've got my piece of cardboard here and I'm just going to drag it over the surface, and you can see actually it's quite interesting because the paint isn't adhering to all of the areas of the picture, or the surface, I should say. It's not a picture really. So it's creating this more sort of torn poster, graffiti style wall, I suppose, which I'm going to work over with my painting. So one other thing I wanted to mention actually about last week's piece, and I think I mentioned it in the narration on the video, is that with this picture, one thing that I find always works really nicely is if you do like just a touch of splattering on the surface without, you know, disrupting the picture too much. But you can see on areas like this just here, perhaps over here, just tiny amounts of splattering. It just creates a little bit more interest in different areas and works quite effectively, I think. So if you're copying directly from a picture, then obviously you can use the same colors that the artist has used. You might choose to use a limited color palette on the surface instead, and then apply some of the other techniques in another color on top later. But I'd like you to sort of improvise a little bit as you go along, or if you feel like you just want to have a go at the techniques and copy the artist, then do that. What I'll need to do before I can start doing the palette painting and trying out the plastic is obviously draw out the portrait of the chap that I'm going to do, this man over here. All right, so the stages are to try out a background if you can, and then draw out your figure, get it dry as quickly as you can. You can use a hairdryer, a lot of artists do that, and then draw out your portrait. You can trace it onto a background like this if you wanted to, and then let's have a go at trying to use some different materials to create the marks, a little bit like Jimmy Law and Francoise Nila. Okay, so are there any questions about any of that at the moment? I'll try and talk a little bit about what I'm doing as I do it this evening. But if you've got any questions about how to go about this, please ask.
I have a question.
Great.
Hello. I've only got, the one type of paper.
Yeah. What have you got? Cartridge or...
300 grams.
Yeah, that's what I've got, yeah.
So that's okay.
Yeah.
Even with paint on it.
Yeah, if you put it on a heater, it will buckle up quite a lot. But this sheet here, which was the first one I did, that went really wrinkly. I I can't quite like that anyway. But what I did then is I just bent it back into shape and rolled it around a little bit, and it's flat enough then for me to be able to work into. Okay.
That Francoise, she must get through an enormous amount of paint.
Yeah, she's even got an assistant to mix it for her.
Intrigues me because they're so big.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, it's so nice. I mean,
and the eyes he did, that other man, I forget his name.
Jimmy.
The eyes he did were amazing.
Yeah.
But I used to follow that Francoise Nielly.
Oh yeah.
I don't know why.
Yeah.
I just liked it once, and then. And in the end, I stopped because there were so many.
Yeah.
But do look, it's just amazing.
Yeah.
Can I show you, Jeremy, what I've started, and maybe
Could
go round with the paper because I've not got it right.
Okay.
Right, there's my
hold
picture.
On. Just wait a second. I've just got to find you.
Find me.
it's good. Hang on, I've got to change the way I'm looking at the.
He is Clive Mirry, who everybody painted.
Oh yeah, with. Yeah. Somebody painted him last. Was it you painted him last week?
He was on Portrait Artist of the Week, and I think about 4,000 people painted him.
Yeah,
and they do amazing. Yeah. But he read my comment out on the telly. So I'm
serious.
I just put
that's great,
brilliant pairing, love your chat and everything. And he said, and Hedda, I went, whoa,
fame and fortune, not fortune, but
right.
Okay, so yeah.
Can you tell me what I've done wrong, or shall I just do making up that whatever?
Just lift him up a little bit.
I think it's
Oh,
I've done it so many times.
Yeah, you're not far off, like, are you?
Like an egghead.
Yeah, his chin comes in a bit more on the right hand side, but not much really. I think his eye on the left hand side is just a little bit larger, as in wider. So if you made that a bit smaller, like this.
Sorry, this one.
Like that, yeah.
I just change that.
Yeah, I think it's just a bit wide, especially in comparison to the other one, but.
Does it need to be up or down then? Sorry, but.
It needs to, as it comes towards the nose, it needs to pinch in a little bit more from the top, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. Just it's only a slight adjustment, really.
Can I stick all that stuff around his head and do that then?
You can do. It might be nice to make the background before as well. So make another background for your next one, and then you'll be ready.
There's what somebody had done.
Yeah, that's great, isn't it?
I was going to try and copy.
Yeah.
But then I didn't want to really copy it exactly. So I don't know what to do now.
Well, you could. You could do, of course, is look at some of the ways that a couple of our other artists have used colour and things, and bring some of that in. I think that's what a lot of people are doing. So like Govinda's done that with a photo of her son. I think she's put some colours. Yeah. Did you see that earlier?
Some bright.
So people are starting to like just try things out a little bit, which is brilliant. Because it pushes you a little bit beyond what we've already done.
My Elvis.
Your Elvis was awesome. I really liked your Elvis.
I'm actually going to frame that one.
Yeah, yeah. He's that was a Paul Wright Elvis, wasn't it?
Yeah. It was more or less, like you say, you do learn from the copy, and it's very good.
You do, yeah.
And they bore your time. They don't know whether to do him or start him.
All right, so you can see here, just chatting, answering a few questions, but there's one example of a background that you can create. You can create backgrounds, of course, using a whole range of materials. You could even use some textured paper. Often in the past, I've used things like wallpapers and things. So what I'm going to do first of all with this background is I'm going to be drawing the picture that you can see up there in the left top left hand corner, and also on the page, of course, on the desk in front of us as well. So first of all, because I've added some white over the top of the collaged background that I made from newspapers, pieces of tape, and a few other little bits and bobs with scraped white paint on top, I can then draw over the top of the picture. You can just put on, you can just scrape on the white paint straight away, actually. Before it's even dried, it doesn't really matter too much. And the idea really, and I keep saying this, is that, you know, it helps to break the ice with the surface that you're working with. In other words, it frees you up right from the beginning. So here, as you can see, you'll see me using the pencil quite a lot to get angles and things whilst drawing the outline of the portrait and things. You can see me again using construction lines. So I've worked out where the angle of the eyes are. I do adjust the eyes a little bit as I progress through this drawing, but then the idea is that you start off with some of the basics and then you start. Then you make adjustments as you go along to make it as close to the drawing or the photograph that you're working from. So you can see that I've got the outline of the jaw, I've got the side of the face, and already I'm making adjustments to the angles. A bit later on, when I paint the face, when I've got quite a way into painting actually, I realised that I needed to adjust the shape of the nose again down that left hand side. But that's absolutely fine, because with the acrylic paints I can work over the top of those quite easily. So I'm picking out all the main shapes here as we go along, and I keep using the pencil again just to check my angles, get the main shapes, the larger shapes in, before then I go in later and refine some of the details. So remember, as I've said many times before, the way to work is to work on the largest areas first, and then build in with, and then gradually hone in, if you like, on the smaller areas as we progress. One thing I could have improved with doing this painting was the perspective in the face, really. The lower jawline, I feel, on my painting at the end was just, could have been just a little bit bigger to emphasize the fact that we're looking at this chap from underneath. So it actually, the features and the eyes and things get smaller as they go kind of upwards, if you like. But mainly I was quite pleased with the end result of this picture. So you can see me using my pencil here to measure. Now what I did at this stage is I measured the distance between the eyes. Remembering, of course, that this is obviously at an angle. It's almost like a three quarters view image, which is one of my favourite angles to draw, actually. So that's quite nice. But the width from where the right hand eye starts and the nose starts actually was a little bit wider than the eye on the right. So I use a pencil to help me navigate the distances there. And I also found the edge of the eye on the right hand side to the edge of the head was a similar distance over there to the ear roll, or to the ears. Okay, so once I've got that, I thought I'm going to make this face stand out, and I've created kind of a grey colour. It looks very blue, of course, because it's blue and a little, it's an ultramarine blue and burnt umber that I've mixed together and then added white to create this kind of nice bluey grey. Not the same colour as on the picture, but still quite nice. And the other difference is, of course, that I've created some texture on the surface, because as you can see,
I am, well, as you could see a minute ago, oh, there you go. I'm scraping the paint onto the surface, onto the bumpy surface of my background, which I put white on just earlier on in this lesson. So we've already got a nice texture to build on top of. What I do later actually is I add a little bit of blue onto that and things as well. So I decided, because this guy has got very, Francoise Nielly has got a lot of heavy dark outlines on this particular portrait, what I did is I started in the spirit of how I wanted to carry on, which was to use a small piece of plastic to start mapping out the angles. I do actually go in later with a nice brush and things, just for ease of use really, but it starts to pick out that portrait quite quickly, which is really good. And then I spotted a few bits that I hadn't included around the bottom of the mouth just there. So here we go, in with a brush, just bringing out some of those finer details with a brush just helps me to pick out the face a little bit more. So, and again here, I'm not, you know, I want to get it quite close to the real thing. But at the same time, I can allow myself a little bit of room for maneuver, if you like, making the odd mistake or whatever, because I can work back over this very quickly, because acrylic, as you may be aware, dries really quickly. So within minutes, this will be dry. And I am actually working in a studio that is quite warm. I've got my radiator right next to me at this desk. So I know the paint's gonna dry really quickly. So I'm using a brush just to map out the rest of the shapes. And there's quite a lot of nice detail shapes in this picture to pick out on. And we can already see different things coming out. I didn't outline much on the lips, because when I looked closer at the lips, I could see the shadows were mostly done in a kind of a dark browny sort of colour. So the next stage, I believe, was I noticed that a lot of the face uses reds and like browns, and there's some really nice bold bright colors in there that I decided I would start off with. So I believe at the moment I'm just mixing a little bit of color, maybe talking to a few people in the class. Here we go. So already we've got a nice clean outline of the picture, and I start generally working over the whole of the picture. Often what I'll say to students is focus on one small area, get it as close to the real thing as you can, so that you can start building up a little bit of confidence about carrying on with the rest. Here though, I'm working over the whole of the picture, putting in little bits of the colour that I can see. So I've mixed a colour. It doesn't have to be absolutely precise, but I start just putting it in there with a smaller palette knife, so scraping it in. Some of the colours on here you'll be able to see through into the whites, because of the nature of what I'm doing, which is scratching the surface. You can see scratches on the surface of the paint that I'm applying. But those like bumpy bits splodges, if you like, of paint, or where the paint is a bit more thicker, will leave a little bit of texture on the surface of the picture, which then I can work back over a little bit later. There we go, a little bit of yellow up there. Now, the interesting thing again about what I'm doing in this picture is that I'm working from a printed version from my own printer at home. So the colours are a little bit different in my print. Usually on a print from my printer, it's an inkjet printer, the colours come out a bit more pale because it's on a white piece of paper. Whereas here on the screen, we're looking at a photograph. So as the painting progresses, I do look at the picture on the screen a little bit more, because I was quite interested in how bright those colours were, and I was interested as well in the variation between the printed version and the version that you can see on the screen here. So this is the bit that takes a bit of time. It's also it can make you a little bit impatient because you want to see the results as quickly as possible. But in a way, it can be quite relaxing if you let yourself or allow yourself to, make the odd colour mistake or the wrong mark in the picture, because you can go over it and you can correct it. And actually building layers of colour on top of each other during the process is a lot of fun, because you get little bits of the other colours you applied underneath coming through inevitably, and it makes the painting a bit richer as far as mark making and colour goes. So now you can see me, the painting's moved a little bit, you can see me adding some greens. So the nice thing about these greens in the painting is that they are opposite colours to the warmer reds and things, which adds a little bit of an accent and a bit more kind of a contemporary feel to the overall picture that we're creating here. The other thing is you've also got little bits of the newsprint poking through the picture, which is not something that Francoise Nielly does. And the idea of this lesson is that we're learning to copy from other artists' work, but when you copy, it's very difficult to get it right. And actually, in the words of Picasso, when you make these botches, you're doing something new. I read a really cool quote about that just yesterday, about how artists should copy other artists' work, because actually it adds to your language and it builds your own skills. Make mistakes, but you make mistakes you can use and things in your own stuff. So it actually forces you to be creative in an original way, believe it or not, by copying other people's work. So whilst adding all of these different colours, it's important to keep an eye on the tonal values of the colours too, whether they're light or whether they're darker colours, and how you actually apply these colours in a lighter or darker way as you work. So for instance, adding touch of red to a bit of green can give you this more kind of earthy organic colour. And if you've got a big range of acrylic colours like I have in this case, then you'll find that different blues and different reds and so forth will actually result in a different colour, which sounds like it makes a lot of sense. But when you look at the colours on your palette and you start mixing them, it's surprising what different things come out of it. So it's building up quite nicely now. There's still plenty of little white patches and things, which when they all get built and put together, will make more of a whole picture. So I have used a brush quite a lot because it's good to get smoother textures or smoother brush strokes in the picture. But I also switch back to a palette knife to add a little bit more texture on there. And you can see just around the temple, that I've added quite a thick layer of that white paint in there, and I'm going back in now and just refining some of the details in the eye just with the black at this point. So I am actually, you know, literally copying exactly what I can see in the picture on here, but because I'm firstly using acrylics and I've got this nice background to work over, it presents different challenges, like a texture. For instance, the texture, there was a folded piece of paper which just happened to be on the left hand eye, which is just under my hand, which I had to keep painting over and around to make the eye work over the course of making the whole of the picture. So I've added a bit of refinement around the eyes. This line I just put in there, I actually end up removing and adjusting a little bit later on in the picture. Right, so carrying on then. See me, I'm yapping quite a lot now. I think we got near the end of the evening lesson at this stage. So carrying on building in some of the darker tones again, working generally around the whole of the picture. The interesting thing is, you know, you work over one area, you come back, you work over it again, you rework it, you make adjustments. One thing I was surprised about is at the end of the evening session on this particular week, I thought, I'm probably only going to spend, 10, 15 more minutes on this painting. But in the following lesson, I did spend pretty much after the introductions and stuff, the rest of the lesson just working into it, refining it, adding more layers of colour and texture into the work. So even when a piece looks finished, you can still keep pushing it. And it's surprising how much just little bits of poking around and adding extra layers of colour can make all the difference to a painting. And you'll probably see that as we progress. And in the painting that Francoise did, her painting up there in the corner, you can see lots of differences in the colour, but you can see how the similarities are starting to appear at the same time. The other thing to note about acrylics, of course, is sometimes you need to build up a few layers of colour to make those colours nice and opaque, because inevitably, and I've talked about this before, if you add one colour on top of another, the colour underneath will influence how the colour on top looks. And later on, in the second part of painting, which is the second lesson, I do actually start just actually getting a tube of paint and putting it on the surface of the picture and scraping it with my palette knife or piece of plastic. Okay, but it's coming along. The other thing you can also do, if you've got your paints and stuff on your palette, is you can use the I use a liquid retardant with the paint as well, which does make the paint a little bit less opaque, more transparent, but it keeps it going for just a little bit longer. Especially if you're in a warm studio like mine, you'll find, of course, that the colours that the paint dries really quickly, especially with acrylics. So here we are on the second day of the lesson, or of this painting. So this is a lesson with the Tuesday class now. So I start to notice a lot more details, and I'm trying to get the right colours according to the print that you can see there on the right hand side. And then occasionally, as we progress through the lesson, I do glance across a lot more. One thing I did notice when I was painting this is there was a lot more darker tones and shadows in the picture, which is what I keep adding and working on as we go through this picture. So one thing to notice about this about the picture as well, something that I've just noticed having sat here talking about it, is that the lips and things are slightly a different shape, and not size necessarily, but they're not quite in the correct position. So that would be something that I would go back and work on. You can see the angle of them. The angle's probably okay, but it probably just needs a bit more shape and moving up slightly. And I think that would then give more room to the chin below the lips and help with that perspective. But saying that, if you hadn't seen the original painting just here, then you probably wouldn't think too much about it if you saw the original picture. But for that reason, I do think that Francoise Nielly's picture has a little bit more of that drama and in it as well, and perspective, I should say, as well. So on this little bit here, I'm just making a few little adjustments to the nozzle just to make things work a little bit better. As you can imagine. And down the bottom there, I just went and scraped on a little bit of white. So that was quite a little bit of a random act, really. I just felt... it just sort of came to me that I wanted to do that and scraped it on. So sometimes these little ideas about adding something extra to a picture can be quite successful and make it a bit more interesting. I think it just adds a little bit more texture to the picture, personally. You can see me here just making some adjustments to the shape of the opening of the mouth and the lips. I can see very clearly where I would change that lip. If I went back and worked on it again, but I'm quite happy with it anyway. It's a nice experiment to be painting in a different way to how I would normally work, and it's great fun just layering colours on top of each other and building up those layers, perhaps using a little bit of a palette knife. Add some texture back in there too. So, as I said earlier, you can tinker around with these things for quite some time. And keep working on them. So I could easily keep working even more than I did in this particular lesson on this piece. So I'm just exaggerating some of the accents of red and things on there now. I don't think I've seen myself apply the paint used directly from the tube at this stage, but I know that at some point I do that quite a bit. That's so that you get the pure colour sitting directly on the surface, and you also get the effect of the texture on there as well. Still noticing things that I haven't put in around those lips again. I'm pretty pleased with that overall. Sometimes I use my finger as well just to move or smudge areas of paint without actually blending it. There we go. So I've just put on some pure paint as well, and I'm sort of using the palette knife to spread it around a little bit. So I think it's come together quite well. Little ray of light coming across the surface of the picture as well from my window. And I'm just getting a little bit of paint on the palette. I added that little line just down the back of the ear there. It was a little bit unintentional actually, but I quite liked it, so I left it there. There we go. So pretty pleased with the overall result. So we've taken a Francoise Nielly painting and we've taken it a little bit further by applying a texture in the background and using slightly different colours and adding different textures, but with a similar, very similar, if not the same effect overall.